بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على رسوله محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين، والسلام تسليما كثيرا كثيرا. أما بعد، سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. Before I begin, I have two important announcements. Number one is that please do sign up if you are willing to go, and if you are planning to go for Umrah, please come forward and please do sign up. Number two is that for those of you who know how to read the Quran, but you need some assistance in knowing how to read the Quran with the correct pronunciation, with the correct tajweed, then inshallah for you there is a program here in the back room where the men's are, the men's back room, for the brothers only after Salat al-Isha on Wednesdays. So once again, if you need help on tajweed, know how to read the Quran with tajweed, then inshallah every Wednesday night after Salat al-Isha there is a program for the brothers. So inshallah we tonight conclude with the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And before I begin and before I get into the main person who we will be discussing tonight, just a few things I want to mention about another wife of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, her name was Maymuna. Maymuna, out of all the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was one who had previously married twice, and then later on when she had become a widow, she had expressed her feelings or her wishes to marry the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to her sister. Her sister was married to Abbas radiallahu ta'ala an, and when Abbas heard this, he came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, informed him of Maymuna's wishes, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he accepted. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam married Maymuna, there was an order that came from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that the Prophet alaihi wasallam is to not marry any more women at that time. So when you include Maymuna into the picture, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he had 9 wives. Remember that Khadija, altogether he had 11 wives. Khadija had already passed away, and Zainab bint Khuzayma was the other wife of the Prophet who passed away during his lifetime. So when he included Maymuna radiallahu ta'ala anha, altogether he had 9 wives. However, there was another woman that came into the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and even though, you know, in some books of history she is considered as one of the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and some books of history she is not counted amongst the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that was Maria Qibtiyya radiallahu ta'ala anha. Now, before we talk about Maria Qibtiyya, it's important to understand where did Maria Qibtiyya come from, and how did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam even come in contact with Maria Qibtiyya. So first of all, is that when you take a step back and you study the history of Islam in Mecca, we learn that the Muslims, they went through many sufferings. They went through many sufferings. And there was not a single order from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowing and permitting the Muslims to defend themselves and to fight back. There was nothing in the Quran, there was no instructions from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So therefore, for 13 years, while the Muslims were in Mecca, they went through many sufferings. Some of them were permitted to go to Abyssinia in order to protect themselves from these sufferings. But nonetheless, after the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam migrated to Medina, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent an ayah in the Quran allowing and permitting the Muslims to fight back and defend themselves. So therefore, we see that whenever there was a threat or whenever there was any tribe making plans or scheming against the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Prophet would not simply just take it and, you know, be patient about it, but he would fight back, and the Sahaba would defend themselves. In the expedition or in the story of Hudaybiyah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it was very clear after Hudaybiyah that Medina was now in the hands of the Muslims. And not only that, but it was very clear for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he was now considered as the official leader of Medina. Now before this, it was very clear that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the leader of Medina, but there was still some doubts in many people's minds. Not the Muslims' minds, not in the mind of a Muslim or a Sahabi or the amongst the Muhajir or the Ansar, but amongst some other people. But after this incident, it was absolutely clear that there is no doubt in the fact that now Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is now the leader of Medina. It was only after Hudaybiyah that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he began to send letters to different rulers and different kings of his time. It was not before this, it was after Hudaybiyah. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he began to send letters to different people. One of the people that he sent a letter to was the king at that time, or the ruler of Alexandria. His name was Muqawqis. And he was considered as a Christian, and all the letters that went from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to these people, there were the same letters that were sent to all of them. There was no different message. The message was very, very clear that I am inviting you to Islam. I'm inviting you to the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is the only deen. This is the only deen that is accepted to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he sent a sahabi by the name of Hatib ibn Abi Balta'a radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. He said, I want you to take my letter to this person. And it said that if you study the history of Egypt at that time, there was a split, because there were some parts of Egypt that were ruled by the Roman Empire, and there was Roman occupation taking place. So therefore, you had the west side, or the western church, which was under the leadership of the Roman, under the Roman Empire, and then you have the Eastern Church, where you had patriarchs and bishops, and Muqawqis, who the leader was, to whom the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent this letter, he came from the Eastern Church. When Muqawqis he read that letter, even though he did admire who the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was. But he told Hatib ibn Abi Balta'a that respectfully, I reject the invitation of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to accept the Shahada, and I am perfectly satisfied with the decision that I have, which is being a Christian. But what he did was, as a courtesy, before Hatib ibn Abi Balta'a left, he gave him few gifts to give to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So one of them was a mule, another of them was a donkey. He sent some clothes for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He sent 1,000 mithqals of gold, which were like gold coins, and he also sent two slave women who were both sisters. He sent both of them to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now you have to understand and remember that that slaves at that time were treated like property. Okay. Slaves were treated like property. So if you want to send a slave with some people, it was absolutely perfectly fine. Now, when she came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he accepted this gift from Muqawqis, and he kept one, and he gave another. He gave the other sister to Hassan bin Thabit radiyallahu ta'ala an. Now, since Maria Qibtiya, she was a slave woman of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or in Urdu we call it bandi or jariya, whatever as you may call it. Nonetheless, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he noticed right away that there was a sense of jealousy. There was a sense of jealousy amongst his wives. Now the reason is because Maria's mother, she was considered as a Roman. She was originally a Roman. And therefore, because she was a Roman, her skin was extremely light. And so therefore, there was a certain type of beauty that she had that some of the other wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not have. Now, does that mean that she is the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? No, she's not. But because she was around the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that is why some of the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they did become jealous. Now, a brother came to me last week and he asked me a question. He said that I heard that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had a child, not from one of his wives, but one of his slave women. Now you have to understand that if you study the history of slavery, not only in the United States of America, but all over the world, you have to understand, first of all, is that Islam did not invent these matters. Slavery existed before Islam, and slavery existed even after the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did was that he made slavery in such a way that he institutionalized rights for the slaves. There was rights for the men's slaves and for the women's slaves. Not only that, but the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he even taught us that if you have a slave, this is how you are to treat them. You are to treat them like family. You are to treat them like they're part of your family, and you are not to yell at them. You are not to do dhulm upon them. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he did not create slavery, but he made slavery more humane. Just like when you study polygamy, you know, Islam has been attacked by so many Islamophobes for the simple reason that Islam permits polygamy. Well, if you look at the other religions, they also permit polygamy. But one thing that we find in Islam, which is very different compared to all the other faiths and all the previous practices, Islam did not invent polygamy. Islam made polygamy more humane. You understand? Islam made polygamy more humane. So we have to understand that this was a practice at that time, that if you did have a slave woman who was yours, first of all, is that how they would treat slave women? If they were yours, no matter if they were yours, they would send them as prostitutes in the city. Islam did not allow that. Islam said that if they are your women, if they are your slave women, then they are not to be sold and they are not to be treated in this manner. But if you, as the man and the master, if you want to take benefit and you want to benefit from them, then that is absolutely permitted. Now, there is a rule also in Islam when you study about slaves. And that was, which was very different from all the previous cultures and all the previous practices. If a master benefited from his slave, and she expected a child and she delivered a child, then in that situation, without any doubt, the woman becomes free immediately. In the books of fiqh, in Arabic, that term was called Ummul Walad. The term that was used in the books of fiqh is called Ummul Walad. And in the rules of Ummul Walad, as soon as she gives birth, then she becomes a free woman. The master doesn't have to say that I free you. By her delivering the baby, she becomes free. Now, in the previous practices, this did not apply to any rules or any laws of slavery. This only existed with Islam. Islam did permit this. Now, it said that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because when he saw that there was so much, there was some envy, there was some jealousy, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he moved Maria Qibtiya from there and placed her in a different place. It said that later on, the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they found out that Maria Qibtiya is expecting a child, and this was the child of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It says that later on, she gave birth to the last child of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whose name was Ibrahim. And Ibrahim was born in the same year that Fath Makkah took place. The conquest of Makkah took place, which was the eighth year after Hijrah. Now, Ibrahim was, it said that every time, or the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he would take time out of his very busy schedule to go and give time to his grandchildren. For example, you had Umama, who was the daughter of Zainab. Zainab radiallahu ta'ala anha was his daughter. Umama was Zainab's daughter, so that becomes the grandchild of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then you have Hassan and Hussein, who were the grandchildren of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the children of his daughter Fatima and his son-in-law Ali radiallahu ta'ala anha. And not only that, but then here you have Ibrahim. And it said that all these, you know, here Ibrahim is not his grandchild. But nonetheless, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would take time out for his children and his grandchildren all the time. You know, subhanAllah, even when it comes to grandchildren or even children, I mean, think about that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is giving a khutbah, and one of the sons, either it was Hassan or Hussein, they're running around, it was Hussein, that he was running around While the Prophet ﷺ is giving khutbah, and he comes to the Prophet ﷺ, and during the khutbah, the Prophet ﷺ, he picks him up and he introduces everyone that, look, you know, this is my grandson Hussein, radiyallahu ta'ala an, and so forth. And he was introducing him during the khutbah time. Not only that, but when the Prophet ﷺ would be praying on his own, and Hassan and Hussein radiyallahu ta'ala anhuma, they would come to the Prophet, they would jump on his back, and they would stay on his back. Not a single time did the Prophet ﷺ, he expressed that he was upset with them. Never. And this goes to show you that how much love the Prophet ﷺ, he had for his grandchildren and for his children. So it said that the Prophet ﷺ, after the birth of Ibrahim, the Prophet ﷺ would go to Maria's house more often to go visit her. However, Ibrahim, the son of the Prophet ﷺ, he only lived for another 18 months. And he was he came down with the flu. And the Prophet ﷺ, the books of history mention that the Prophet ﷺ, he did everything that he could in his capacity for Ibrahim. But it was the divine decree, or the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Ibrahim is not to live for more than 18 months in this world. And therefore he passed away. And he was the last child to pass away. Remember that all the children of the Prophet ﷺ, they passed away during his lifetime, except for Fatima. Fatima was the only one who was alive. And it said that while the Prophet ﷺ, he was burying Ibrahim, he was crying. He was crying quite a bit. And the Sahaba, they came to the Prophet ﷺ, they consoled the Prophet ﷺ, and the Prophet ﷺ, he was heard saying that إِنَّ الْعَيْنَ تَدْمَعَ وَالْقَلْبُ يَحْزُنَ, that the eyes, they shed tears, and the heart grieves. And then he says that we shall not say anything which pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But then he did say that وَإِنَّا بِفِرَاقِكَ يَا إِبْرَاهِيمَ لَمَحْزُونُونَ, that we are, O Ibrahim, by your departure, we are extremely saddened. And so the Prophet ﷺ, he was extremely emotional when the Prophet ﷺ was burying Ibrahim, his son. And this is actually this is recorded in the books of Ahadith. We don't find in the other kids of the Prophet ﷺ that while he was burying them, he was that emotional. But what is mentioned about Ibrahim ﷺ is truly moving. There is nothing that is mentioned in the books of Sirah that the Prophet ﷺ did an official nikah with Maria Qibtiya. Maria Qibtiya was the mother of Ibrahim, so when she lost Ibrahim, there's nothing that is mentioned about her. So the general consensus, or the agreement, is that she probably just moved on with her life. But there's nothing that mentions that she married the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because once again, after marrying Maymuna, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that you are not to marry anyone else. After the death of Ibrahim, it is mentioned that there was an eclipse that took place in Medina, and many people, they began to say that this eclipse has taken place because of the death of Ibrahim. And that is when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he came and he said that the sun and the moon are both the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they do not eclipse due to the death of someone or any major event that would take place. Now, what is mentioned in the books of Sirah, or in the tafsir, in the tafsir, especially if you read the tafsir of Surah Al-Kawthar, in the ayah, إِنَّ شَانِئَكَ هُوَ الْأَبْتَرُ, there were many people who began to say that who is going to revive or continue the legacy of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam if he does not have any boys. Like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if you study all his children, all his girls, they lived a life. They lived a life. However, as far as his three boys are concerned, they never actually lived a life. They passed away when they were extremely young. And that's why many people, they came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The kuffar will come to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they will say that he has been like cut off. Like he doesn't have a lineage. There is nothing that will continue his legacy after that. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he said, "Inna shani'aka huwa al-abtar," basically in the tafsir is mentioned that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling those people who made a mockery of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that indeed you are the ones who are cut off. The legacy of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam will continue. It will continue without any doubts. But it is not the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam who is deprived. It is you people who are making a mockery of him. That you are the ones who are deprived. So we don't find any sons of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam who actually played a major role in spreading his deen. And that goes to show you that, you know, there is a belief within our societies that you need to have sons to continue your legacy. And that's not true. There are a lot of people who only have daughters, and they feel like that, you know what, I have no one after this that I can continue my legacy with. And that's not true. There's so many things that you can do within a community, within a society, and during your lifetime, that after you pass away, you can leave behind a legacy for yourself. You don't need only boys to leave a legacy behind for yourselves. Finally, Maria Qibtiyya, she lived on after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It said that during the time of Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, knowing very well that she was the free slave of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because she gave birth to one of the children of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Abu Bakr, he financially took care of her. After he passed away, Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu financially took care of her, and finally she passed away in the 16th year after Hijrah. It said that Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he gathered everyone to witness her Salatul Janazah, and she, you know, the Janazah was prayed upon her, and then she was buried in Jannatul Baqir, which is right next to Masjid Nabawi. So she was buried over there. So we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the little that these women they had in the lives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So we now come to an end. Now there was, I'm not going to get into her and who this woman was, but just to make all of you aware, there was one woman who did not exist during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In fact, she passed away before the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam even came to this world, but she will also be the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Jannah, and that is Asiya bint Muzahim, who was the wife of Fir'aun. Okay, we know that the wife of Fir'aun was a believer. Fir'aun was not a believer, so she will, on the day of judgment, be with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and she will be admitted into Jannah as a wife of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So inshallah, we come to an end with all the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now inshallah, we'll get into some of the mothers, the women who took care of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then we'll get into some of the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum. But for next week inshallah, I want to do something a little different. I'm planning to do like sort of like a quiz on all the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And what I want to do is, how many of you have heard, it's a program that a lot of college professors and teachers they use, is called Kahootit. How many of you have heard Kahootit? Kahootit. Have you heard of what Kahootit is? Okay. Kahootit is something that a lot of the youngsters, I'm sure they know what that is. Obada, you know what that is, right? Okay. So what this is that basically it's a program that you feed all your questions in there, and you feed your answers in there too. And what happens is that you will, you know, next week on your phones, you go to the website kahoot.it, and there will be a code. You put in that code and you put in your name and your last name initial, and you enter into the competition. And what happens is that all the questions are going to be on the projector, and instead of having A, B, C, and D as your multiple choice, you're going to have different colors and different shapes. And on your phone, you just select your answer, and it will give you the right answer. And it doesn't only judge you based on the right answers, but it judges you based on how quickly you answer the question too. So if there is one brother who answered all the questions perfectly fine, but he took long, like if the time limit is 15 seconds, and every single time he chose his answer at the 14th second, if there's another brother who chose his answers in the first 5 seconds and he got all his right, he comes on top. He is higher. So there's usually five places, the five top places, inshallah. So if we have so many people here, we'll choose the first five, and inshallah there'll be a small prize, inshallah, for that too. So make sure you have your phones next time. Make sure they're charged, and make sure you have some good data on it too, inshallah. So inshallah we'll do this next week, inshallah. It's called Kahoot It. We'll do this inshallah next week. Jazakumullah khair. Subhanallah bihamdi. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Jazakumullah khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Dua alim inshallah.